No matter how much money you've got invested in your race car, ultimately it comes down to the contact patch between your four tyres and the racetrack that's going to define how your car will handle and how fast it will be. A key component of optimizing that contact patch, of course, is the dampers and the suspension system. Now, conventionally, we have dampers with adjustable bump and rebound. However, this is an adjustment that we make in the pits, and that could be a compromise for a certain part of the track. And we're here with Tom from DSC Sport to talk about tunable suspension. In particular, DSC is the US distributor and importer of TracTive Suspension. So, Tom, before we get into your electronic controls, can we just talk a little bit about what TracTive coilover suspension or dampers are? Where is the advantage with that TracTive suspension?
TracTive makes a great coilover system. They have that patented DDA valve, which is the fastest electronic valve in the world at 6 milliseconds. So using our controlling algorithm, it can change the damping curve 166 times per second.
All right, so what you're talking about there, instead of a conventional manual adjuster for bump and rebound, or maybe you've got multiple adjustments for high speed and low speed bump and rebound, this is all done internally within the shock, within the damper, electronically?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, with our software, we're using G-force as the primary load. It's always looking for a certain G-force signature. So regardless if you have changing conditions or a different driver that delivers the car to a corner a little bit different way, it will show a different G-force signature, and that's how we set the damping. And on top of that, we're offsetting the actual driving situation with high speed, low speed, medium speed, compression and rebound based on the signal from the ride height sensor, as well as vehicle speed. Just like you would tune a ECU for the engine, you have your main table and then you have other offset tables.
All right, you've just dumped a huge amount of information there. So I want to just go back and unpack a little bit of that bit by bit. So first of all, you've just talked about low speed, medium speed, and high speed for compression and rebound dampening. So just for our enthusiasts watching this, maybe they're not completely familiar with how that's going to affect the way the car handles. Can you just talk to us, either with a manual or your automatic electronic control, what those three areas, medium, low speed, high speed damping, actually affect?
Yes, absolutely. So we're actually not talking about vehicle speed. We're talking about suspension travel speed.
So the rate of change of the suspension movement.
Yeah, as far as low speed is concerned, we consider 0 to 2 inches per second low speed. So 2 to 6 is medium speed, and 6 to 20 plus is high speed. So if you were to hit a bump, that would be high speed. And loading the car up in a long sweeper, that's low speed.
So essentially, in real simplistic terms, the low speed is the sort of stuff where the driver's actually moving the wheel, turning the car into a corner, and it's sort of pitching or moving around and rolling. So that's control of that aspect of the suspension. At the other end, high speed, maybe where we run a curb and the suspension is forced into bump travel very, very quickly. Is that a reasonable way of breaking it down?
Yeah, you're 100% correct.
All right, so again, we talked about the conventional manual bump and rebound adjuster, and at some point we're making compromises. Maybe it'll work really well on a section of corners, but there's another set of corners that maybe aren't quite ideally suited. So you've got the ability to change the bump and rebound dampening as the car's going around the track, and this is where your DSC control module comes in. So before we get into the logic behind that control, what sensors are required in order to use this system?
Oh, we have two lines of system, plug and play, hence the name, for cars that come from the factory with electronic suspension. So these cars already have enough sensors on the CAN bus. So what we do is we read the factory CAN bus, and the CAN bus rates 500 hertz, 500 times per second. So we can get a lot of information from brake pressure, vehicle speed, to accurately get the damping commands that we want for the situation.
Just with those systems where you plug and play, I'm right in saying you're still swapping out the factory dampers with the TracTive, but you are just saving money and simplicity by reutilizing all of those factory sensors, that's what you're saying?
Yes, that's correct, because the sensors are already there, so why not use it? And they're pretty quality sensors for these newer cars. And our controller will actually work with the OE electronic shocks too, but nowhere as good as TracTive, of course.
All right, so you've got the sensors, whether that's a plug-and-play system or you're reading your new sensors in that you've added in with a standalone system. So you mentioned there sort of a little bit like tuning a standalone aftermarket ECU for engine control. That's what you've likened it to. What sort of control do we have? Maybe talk us through a little bit about that logic of the control system and how that's really going to benefit a car out on the racetrack.
Okay. Yeah, we have a load dependent system, just like engine ECU have, and our primary load is the G-force. So we're always looking for a G-force signature. So that table is pre-written by us. In fact, every controller that we sell is already mapped very well. We spend a lot of time on it. Now, the other sensor that comes into play is brake line pressure, because in a braking event, the brake line pressure rises before the G-force. You're talking about a split second, but nonetheless, it's advanced. So we're using the brake line pressure to preempt the damping force before the G-force actually occurs. So that's one way to tune it. As far as other sensors that are used are the velocity sensors. We talked about that briefly before. So if you were braking and you happen to be braking on a bumpy patch, the sensors will pick up the patch and then we will subtract X amount of damping force to make the car a lot more compliant so the car is not uncomfortable and it remains stable in the braking zone.
All right, so again, just breaking that down into something in real simple terms, you're talking about you're coming into a braking zone, you've got your suspension with bump and rearbound damping that's relatively compliant so that it's not skipping over bumps. When you hit the brakes, you're going to end up essentially with weight transfer towards the front of the car, so you are stiffening the front suspension and sort of a result of that to try and optimize the braking force. But if you were by chance on a very bumpy section, then you would actually soften it slightly to remain compliant over that bumps. Is that sort of how I'm reading that?
Yes, that's correct, because we're offsetting it, in other words.
Okay, so basically you've got some base tables in there you can tune, but the system is smart enough to be active as you're going around the racetrack?
Yes, it's active all the time.
Now, one thing that concerns me here is I know that most track day enthusiasts, and maybe the system's a little bit beyond the track day enthusiasts, it's a very high-end professional system, but they struggle with just setting a single bump and rebound adjuster manually. So when we're throwing this much adjustability and control, my guess is if you didn't know what you're doing, it would be possible to actually go backwards and end up with a worse result. How do you guide a person through making calibration adjustments and getting a better result with this active suspension system?
What you just said is completely true. I've been doing this for 24 years, and you can definitely could go down a wrong path in manual adjustment. So with the electronic, we mostly eliminated this possible error by providing a very good base map. Now, with our plug-and-play controller, instead of tuning for what you expect the peak load to be, we are tuning for the driver. So instead of tuning from the tire up, we're actually tuning from the steering wheel down. So it's using the driver's reaction, braking, steering, in order to trigger the next set of commands. So in that way, it simplifies the tuning process because it's already pre-written in an algorithm.
So essentially, you could put this in the car, you could expect a really good improvement over a passive system anyway. And if you really want to dive in deep, you've got the data to back it up and the knowledge to back it up. There's potential to make improvements for a particular track, a particular driver preference, and how your car's set up.
That is true. And we've proven this by doing a number of track demos. Jeremy and I have gone to different tracks, and obviously the driver has to be familiar with the car and that track. After they do a couple of warm-up sessions, we will swap it out, and 99% it will show an improvement in the lap times.
It's actually probably a good time to ask. So if we're going from a conventional passive suspension system, one that's already well dialed into a particular chassis, a driver, and a given track, swapping from that passive system across to your active system with TracTive coilover, suspension, dampers, and setting that up properly, can you give us an indication of what sort of lap time should you expect to be able to drop?
Well, the lap time is going to depend on the length of the track and the driver and the conditions, of course. I have also worked in a pro race team. We won 24-hour races and championships. But in such an environment, if you have top engineers with great drivers, with great feedback, you're looking at the data, and then that passive suspension is fully set up for that condition for that day, the improvement is going to be very little. But most people don't have the resources to do this. So with our electronic, it could take their car without the engineer, without the pro driver feedback to that level. Now, and then even in a pro race level, with this level of resources, this our system will show a significant advantage during the race if there's a changing condition. If it starts raining in a race, we don't have to come in and change to a rain setup. It will automatically detect the change in the G-force signature, because in the rain, naturally, you're running less G-force. So you automatically have a rain setup for changing conditions. Or if you have to take an offline somewhere, take a different line, it will change the G-force profile and our system will remap it instantly.
Now, another thing you mentioned off camera before we started recording here was that you can essentially instigate an electronic bump rubber or bump stop, which is something that really interested me. So a lot of people, the bump rubber there is kind of the last line of defense before the shock bottoms out, preventing tire contact with the chassis. A lot of cars now, though, that are running a lot of high aero download, this becomes a bit of a compromise, and some of them are actually now relying on the bump rubbers so that at very high speed, where they've got potentially 2,000 kilograms or more of downforce, the car isn't physically running onto the ground. Now, how does this electronic bump stop work, and how controllable is that?
It is very controllable. Well, first, this is a very advanced feature that we use. We don't expect every user to use it, but for those who actually need it and want to use it, in the velocity table that we have, once the ride height is zero, and we can fill in a numeric value. So once it gets to a certain travel point, the electronic bump rubber will begin, which we would command it, the shocks to increase the damping force. And we can also have a ramp angle to ramp up the force so it's not so abrupt.
That's a really important aspect with tuning the bump stops as well. If you're going to be running onto them, a lot of people run a very, very hard bump rubber, and essentially as soon as the corner of the car runs onto that bump rubber, your spring rate essentially goes to infinity, overloads that particular corner of the car. So what you're talking about there is tuning the damper position where the bump rubber will start to contact, or the electronic bump rubber starts to contact, but then you can also control essentially electronically the stiffness of that bump rubber?
Yes, that's correct. We have all of these dampers are amperage based, it's a current based. We can control the peak stiffness of the electronic bump stop. You can change the ramp angle of it.
Awesome product, really, really innovative, and sort of almost hails back to some of the F1 active suspension technology starting to trickle down into road user cars and enthusiast track day cars. Could you give us, obviously it's going to be very application dependent, but just so our viewers sort of have some idea of the ballpark, could you tell us sort of what a kit would be worth?
Well, we actually have two lines of products. We have our plug-and-play controller. They range anywhere from $1,000 US to $1,300 US. It will plug and play to a newer car with electronic suspension.
So that's where you're controlling the existing shocks.
That's correct. And the TracTive coilover package is what we consider a stage two package with our controller. And it's very vehicle dependent. That it will range anywhere from $5,000 US to $7,000 US. They will all have monoball top plates, applicable springs, and some of the McPherson strut designs is going to be on the higher end versus the eyelet to eyelet traditional shock design.
At the end of the day, though, when you're developing a race car, $5,000 to $7,000 US, if it's going to give you a significant improvement in lap times, that could be considered really well worth it, good value for money. Look, Tom, thanks for the chat there. If people want to find out more about your products, the DSC controllers and the TracTive suspensions, where can they head to?
Our website is www.dscsport.com.
That's great. Thanks a lot, Tom.
Thank you very much for the opportunity.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.